Hi, I want to welcome you all to the Historical Archive, and I hope in the future I will be able to organize again another event. Thank you all for coming. Modes of dress are determined and influenced by various considerations, such as the economy structure, the prosperity of a place, as well as the moral values in a society. Fashion do not rise on their own, but result from border changes, urban, economic, social, or cultural. Nevertheless, it does not remain stationary, but changes through the years, following the trends of times. In this sense, it is permanent to briefly review certain events that occurred during the time that shaped dress in Cyprus, which became property of various nations, states, who left their mark on the local culture and dress. After the Lusignans and the Venetians, Cyprus became part of the Ottoman Empire. For the three centuries that followed, the island was transformed. New administration, new systems of taxation, different use of land, resources and economy. Then Cyprus became part of the British Empire until its independence. As such, material dress culture can function as a testimony for both style of the local population in Cyprus and as reflection of the political environment. In the 18th and 19th century, Cypriot dress underwent a transformation from traditional to modern, from local to cosmopolitan. This transaction from one kind of attire to the other occurred gradually, always depending on the speed of urban growth of each religion. As was common in an era when empires could disintegrate or transform into nations, national dress could come into existence as a means of ethnically unifying national population. That is more accurately described as ethnic or regional dress, the national dress, helped to unify diverse populations and to define national borders. Through national dress was short-lived as a way of dressing, it paved the way towards international fashion and westernization of the local population. Most Cypriots abandoned the traditional dress in favor of styles inspired by Western European fashion. Through the centuries, Cyprus, an island of Eastern Mediterranean, became property of various nations who left their mark on the local culture and dress. During the Lusignans and Venetians periods, there was a shift towards European dress. There are noticeable changes in the dress of the donor portraits in churches commissioned by local Cypriots. These changes are a reflection of the transition between the Lusignan and the Venetian rule. Cyprus was a part of the Byzantine Empire until it was captured in 1911 by the English King Richard Lionheart. Cyprus came under Frankish domain when it was transferred in 1992 to Guy de Lusignan, the dispossessed King of Jerusalem. For hundreds of years, Cyprus have been a stopping point for pilgrims, merchants, and later for crusaders on their way to Holy Land. This exposure to cross-culture trade, migrations, and differing reasoning powers makes Cyprus a complex study in social history. This layer of mixed social identities across ethnic, religious, and political boundaries are documented in the island's donor portraits since no other material evidence has survived. These family portraits indicate political changes on the island, especially as Cyprus moves from a feudal society to a commercial one in the Venetian period. European fashion in the donor portraits is noticeable since the wives are wearing a cloak-like veil that was supposedly introduced from Syria at the end of the 13th century. Gradually, the veil appears to be more lightweight, black, and attached to the band of stiff headdress and falls behind the shoulders. In Cyprus, these examples of the first category veils included in the portrait of the Frankish lady Atasinu and the wife of the Virgin Hodegera, icon dating to the 14th century. The Frankish women, the Narthes of Kakopetria, may also have this type of headdress. The Augustinian monk Jacob de Verona, who traveled in Cyprus in 1335, noted that all the ladies of Cyprus wore a full-length black cloak over their heads. Later, Cyprus became part of the Ottoman Empire. For the three centuries that followed, Cyprus was part of the multicultural empire centered on its capital, Istanbul, which was the focus of fashion, economy, and political power. When Cyprus became part of the Ottoman Empire, the urban higher social classes responded by fostering the contemporary Ottoman trends in dress. The Cypriot dragomans, the interpreters, would from then on wear a jupé and the kalpak. The jupé was a silved overgarment open all the way down at the front. The best samples were lined with fur. The kalpak was a large fur hat. The female dress was composed of a long sleeve kaftan called anderi. Women wore a chemise underneath, large pantaloons and headdress. Cypriot dragomans, Hadzigeorgakis, Kornesios and Christofakis, that engaged in bourgeois professions, both wore the typical Ottoman dress. Oriental dress was promptly adopted by the upper classes, as privileged persons could afford to buy high-quality imported items. Similar remarks were made by Giovanni Mariti, who lived on the island from 1760s to 1765. The men dress a la Turca, like those of Constantinople, and so do the women of any position, except as to the adornment of the head, which is high and striking. However, the Ottoman dress code could soon begin to change. Despite strong obsession of Janitsari and Ulema, those dress references remained strictly traditional. Selim III applied European changes to the military dress code, adopting Western styles, tight pants and short jackets for the army uniforms. According to Otto Friedrich von Richter, who visited Cyprus in 1816, the attraction that Larnaca offers to the European returning from Asia are various traces of Europeanism in the local dress codes. Here, the hat has pushed the turban aside. In 1827, Sultan Mahmud II designed a new military uniform, replacing the turban with the fez, a cylindrical cap of red felt wool with silk tassel hanging on the top. Later, the fez, together with a skirt with a collar and a frock coat, was a standard dress of governmental employees. Non-Muslims, especially Greek and Armenians, were the first to adopt Western fashion in clothing, while the Muslim community adopted changes more slowly or partially. In 1821, the Greeks declared independence. Anticipating an insurrection movement in Cyprus, its government, Kutsuk Mehmet, adopted strict measures and tactics. The independent Kingdom of Greece was established in 1933. The bonds between Greeks and Cypriots and mainland Greeks were strengthened, which also affected the dress habits, since the Cypriot elite attempted to follow the trends set by the Greeks. King Otto and Queen Amalia arrived from Barbaria to Greece in 1837. Upon an arrival, they adopted a different interpretation of the Greek popular costumes, such as romantic folklorist dress worn at the court. It was known to the Greeks as Amalia National Greek Costume. The Amalia costume was inspired by contemporary European fashion and the Greek traditional dress. Its composition was based on a combination of Eastern and Western dress elements. This was both a motion for a national dress and a statement, and the newly formed Greek kingdom had made a transition from its Oriental past to the Western modernity. The Amalia dress influenced the independence as well as the Ottoman urban centers in the Balkans, while also including the islands, even Cyprus. In 1878, Cyprus was an undeveloped rural country, lacking infrastructure and serious industrial production. However, progress was gradual, and that was especially obvious in the urban centers. Europeanization trends were apparent before Cyprus was ceded to Great Britain. Through the Cypriot costumes in the National Historical Museum that were collected by Yorgos Frangoudis for the Cypriot exhibition organized by the Patriotic Association of Cyprus in Athens in 1901, it is obvious that countryside was more traditional and the cities had more European influences. The Cyprus Convention was ratified in Berlin in summer 1878 between the Ottoman Empire and Great Britain. Great Britain would guarantee the military support of the Ottoman Empire against the threat of Russian Empire in exchange for the administration of the island of Cyprus for an annual fixed payment, tribute. Lieutenant General Sir Garret Wolseley was the first High Commissioner of Cyprus. By 1917, the Ottoman Empire had joined Germany in the First and Second War and Cyprus was annexed to Great Britain. In 1923, Turkey waived its rights on Cyprus with the Treaty of Lausanne. In 1925, Cyprus was proclaimed a crown colony of the Great Britain. The British rule was characterized by rapid social and economic growth in the urban districts, which was constant with the slow development in the rural areas. The new status quo manifested as developments in technical, political, and social sector, which would define both the setup and the character of urban Cyprus, as well as the Cypriots' ways of life. The private and public spheres in Nicosia were to take shape against the background of an establishment of the new British administration of Cyprus. Soon after the British rule was established in 1878, the first male travelers began arriving to the island, describing in their notes the local dress attire. There were mostly English women interested in getting to know the new British colony. Foreign travelers would provide further information about the costume worn by the inhabitants of the island in the opening years of the 19th century. They all concentrated on women's ensembles, ensembles that survived virtually unchanged till the beginning of the 20th century. These costumes are often referred to with their original names. In 1894, Magna Helena Sorf accompanied her husband, German archaeologist Max Offenbacher Richter, to Cyprus. Having studied the customs of the island and being able to make comparisons with those of antiquity, Magda was different from typical British female travelers of her time. She was very interested in ethnography and cataloged the different styles of clothes that existed at the time. All types of traditional village dress reminisce of 18th century or earlier urban styles. The oriental looking type of long dress, open with sleeve, low cut on the bottom, secured at the waist and worn over a white chemise and pantaloons, survived until the middle 20th century in the form of traditional costumes with the saya in the most conservative region of rural Cyprus. Alongside the traditional costume, there was a newer type of dress. The skirt, which was European in form, arrived in Cyprus via the independent Greece mainland as variation of Amalia national costume of the late 19th century. This ensemble consisted of a pleated white cotton petticoat, short off-white silk chemise with low sleeves and long skirt. There is a black felt velvet jacket, the sarka, with two types of gold ornamentation. A fez was worn on the head, adorned with various cotton laces which formed flowers in relief. In urban centers, the way a woman was dressed and her jewelry was indication of her social status. References of men costumes are few. However, Magda noted the most typical characteristic of traditional male Cypriot costume. This featured a shirt, a vraka, baggy trousers, zipuni, waistcoat, zostra, a belt at the waist, a fez with or without headscarf and boots. A number of various small industries developed in Cyprus in the first half of the 20th century. They were, however, dependent on raw materials produced locally. A great variety of excellent quality silk, cotton, and flax fabrics manufactured on hand looms were produced and sold in European, Near Eastern, and local markets. The sewing machine was the hallmark of the Industrial Revolution at the end of the 19th century. This gave a huge push to illustrated fashion publications and patterns for embroidery. Sewing machines were sold in the countryside, while schools taught professional cutting and tailoring, and form classroom trainings became more common. The sewing machine made it possible for the amateur sewer to keep up with current fashions. Paper patterns allowed women to make fashionable garments and brought fashion closer to the common people. The trend towards urbanization is reflecting in the increasing number of these new occupations, such as dressmakers, costumiers, hat makers, stocking makers, and hand knitters. They created a modern lifestyle and were the first who donned Frankish attire. This new era left was reflected in the appearance and behavior of the inhabitants of urban environments. British rule enhanced the urbanization of Cyprus to a great degree. These new social events created the need of a new type of clothing. The common dress consisted of two parts, a bodice and a skirt. The bodice was mounted on the bone with silk foundation. It had a high neck, long sleeves, and it was fastened with metal eyelets and hooks. There could be a handmade lace trimmed on white net with white silk thread. The skirt could have been pleated for better application. The dress could be accompanied with gloves and hats decorated with flowers. The bags and the hats were definitely imported due to the difficulty of manufacturing them. So, at that time, people had started to systematically follow fashion trends and use imported goods, mainly from Great Britain. As Greece entered the Second World War in the 1940s, the British authorities urged Greek Cypriots to fight on the side of Greece for freedom, which many Cypriot volunteers did. After the end of the war, Cypriots were hoping for the unification of Greece to be allowed. However, their demand for the union was denied. This resulted to the launch of an armed struggle of independence in 1955, which was carried on until 1959. Cypriots tried to find many ways to protest apart from armed struggle. Their boycott movement against imported fabrics and clothes was the most popular action. The alagetina, cotton dresses and costumes, were originally meant as an act of passive resistance of the Cypriots against the British rule during the 1955-1959 anti-colonial struggles. These clothes and fabrics were made in Cyprus, utilizing only locally made materials. Given the fact that the island produced first-class cotton, it was suggested that cotton cloth be woven and used. Dresses were made by alagia and were decorated with traditional embroidery or needlework. The concept behind passive resistance was a policy of not violent economic warfare, following an example of India. The movement would make a systematic effort to finally weaken the government by refraining from buying and consuming British goods. The boycott targeted the material, not the tailoring and the design of the garments. This was a strong indication that the Europeanization had been accomplished to a great extent. The signing of London and Zurich Treaty in February 1959 heralded a new period of changes. On December 13, 1959, Archbishop Makarios III was elected first president of the newly independent states with Fazil Kutchuk as vice president. On August 15, 1960, the island was officially proclaimed the Independent Republic of Cyprus, with Nicosia being its capital city since. Under this new idea of liberation democracy, people could now express themselves as European and freely choose attire closer to their preference. Eponymous tailors began appearing, creating fashionable dress and suits. The development and modernization of the urban environment is reflected upon constant changes in all kinds of social interactions. Such changes emerged slowly after the 19th century, shaping a new universal language of the interaction of people, now that traveling and exchanging goods and ideas is easier than ever before. The importance of class, financial status, age, background begins to fade in contrast to fashion and creativity, who represent the next evolutionary step of the social interaction of individuals. In Cyprus, as in the rest of Europe, trends become fashion with a strong notion of multiculturalism and cosmopolitanism. These trends become lifestyle and trading commodities. The need for fashion and interactualism derives from the growth of urbanization. The urban environment is not longer being utilized as a protective barrier against elements of nature or invading forces. It is now the launching pad of the human expression and creativity. It is used as an interaction platform from different cultures and trends. Thank you.